Let's worship God. Hallelujah. We're going to have a great time. Amen. Praise Adonai. Here we go.
Who is like him? The Lion and the Lamb, seated on the throne. Mountains bow down, every ocean flows to the Lord of hosts. Who is like him? The Lion and the Lamb, seated on the throne. Mountains bow down, every ocean flows.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes.
Lifted up,
I'll hold her in the for your eyes. magnify you and stand in awe before your throne, rejoicing in the freedom that you have purchased for us on the cross. Hallelujah. Lift up your voice. Let's clap and let's rejoice. Let's glorify God. Declare him as Lord today. Oria ravila raba shoria yendere ala ramando rodorobo say. Hallelujah, Lord, you are worthy to be praised and glorified. In the name of Jesus, amen. We are excited. Post-conference phase of our year is now starting officially this morning. God's moving, doing great things. We want to pray, first of all, for all those that are traveling home today. Some will be going home tomorrow and this week. And all of the new churches that we planted, God would even now begin to open doors and make a way in Scotland, in Bogota, Colombia, in Havana, Cuba, throughout Mexico, the two churches we planted there in Mexico. Let's believe God for great things in Shanghai, China. A lot of times when we send a missionary into a foreign country, he gets there and God has already set things in motion. One of our missionaries got there, met a guy at a train station that spoke English, and I believe that guy is still with him to this day interpreting. So God can move. So let's pray for all of those circumstances. We want to remember healing this morning for Denise Marcotte. My mother-in-law broke her hip, having quite a few complications as a result of that, still in the hospital. We need to pray for a miracle in her body. Mary Reina, Pepe Siqueiros, Jesus Molina, we're continuing to pray for all these. Vicky Ortiz, Emilio Martinez needs a miracle of healing also this morning. We want to remember to pray for our services today, that God would move powerfully. Pastor Jerry this morning and Pastor Gonzalez tonight. Roderick Gonzalez will be ministering tonight. Let's pray for the windows of heaven to be opened and great outpouring of God's Spirit and power. We want to pray for our nation, for a revival in our country, which is desperately needed. We're praying for our president, elected officials, and all those in positions of authority, including our city here in El Paso. We want to remember our youth, revival among young people. Amen. We're praying for God to move powerfully, not only those youth in our church, but of course throughout our city, throughout the school system, that revival would break out. We want to pray for military personnel, soldiers, men and women stationed here in El Paso, all around the world. We're specifically continuing to pray for Cynthia Medina, stationed in Poland, that God's grace would be upon her life, keep her in safety. We want to remember veterans that are all over the country, all over the world, that God's grace would overshadow them, police officers, firefighters, and medical personnel, first responders, that God's power and blessing would be there. We want to remember Pastor Mitchell. He's in San Antonio this weekend preaching the gospel, God's grace over his life. Pastor and Mona Warner, we're praying for the favor of the Lord upon them. Greg and Lisa Mitchell, God's continued help and grace. We want to remember some of our pastors and missionaries, Luis and Cynthia Gutierrez here in El Paso, Chris and Tanya Padilla in Juarez, Mexico, Albert and Yoli Martinez in Clearwater, Florida, Juan and Sylvia Sistersick in Tehuacan. And of course, we can't name every one of our missionaries and pastors, but we lift up every need today. Believe God for great things. We want to continue to pray for Anthony Cobos, for God's grace and vindication over his life and for his family, Ray and Vera and family, the Valverde family. They have special needs. We want to remember Justin Underwood, Michael Cordova, Vicky Ortiz, the Guzman family, Rachel Ponce, Denise Manzano. Those are all for salvation. Many other needs are represented here this morning. I want you to feel free to lift those up before God. Let's pray for the services. Maybe you have a special need or you know some issues on your heart. Lift that up before the Lord. And then as we subside, Ray is going to come. Ray Ortiz is going to come to the microphone and open our service in prayer. Let's touch heaven right now with faith. Amen. Father, we thank you so very much right now for the grace of God, the favor of the Lord that is so evident and powerful and prevalent in our lives. Lord, have liberty and right of way so that your will and your purposes are accomplished.
Lord God, we just give you all the praise and all the glory for meeting with us this day, Lord. And I ask, Mother God, take note of the hearts that are open before you, that you would move in circumstances and situations, Lord. And I ask, Mother God, allow your presence to speak into our hearts this day. Allow us to be able to receive from you. Allow us to be desperate for you. Allow us to have an expectation of your power in this day. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Amen. Take a moment to greet and welcome one another as you're being seated. Praise the Lord. Amen. It's great to be gathered together today. We had our, amen, I can say it, we had our very, very best conference ever. Most international works planted, churches planted here in the U.S. A lot of exciting news. I could really feel a shift happening in our church when I made those Thursday announcements, and Tony and Marina Arroyo and Richard and Luz Contreras have surrendered their churches and their situation to go and pioneer again in a foreign country. I could feel something happening in our church. The offering and the response was overwhelming. We need lots of money to pull all of these moves off and do everything, but you all responded in a record way. Every single offering this week was a record offering, except one, but that one was a very, very good offering. And so I so appreciate, I can't express how grateful I am to partner together with all of you. We're part of something incredible. To be present in the conference this week would change any life that was here. Full house and serious men's class. So many men talking to me about once and for all wanting to go for God in their life. So we're appreciative of all that. We welcome everybody this morning. Let's give everybody a very warm welcome today. Let me just make the announcements for today. This afternoon, we have prayer meeting at 5:30. Why don't we make it a point to fill the prayer room up? No days off. I know it's been in conference. We've been in conference. We've heard 17 sermons in the last 6 days. More than that, actually, if you count last Sunday morning and what you're going to hear today. But come to prayer tonight. Let's lay hold of God. We need him more than ever, and let's fill the prayer room up. We pray in the fellowship hall at 5:30, and then at 6:30 tonight, pastor and missionary Roderick Gonzalez is going to be ministering. He currently is a missionary in Shenzhen, China. So you're not going to want to miss that message tonight. I preached last week on the subject of preaching and how you need to hear every single word that flows from this pulpit. So I challenge you to be here tonight. Make that a regular commitment of your life that you're going to be in every service, no more Sunday morning only. But you come every service because you know that's the priority of life. So tonight, prayer at 5:30, and the service is at 6:30, Pastor Roderick Gonzalez. Then all through the week, we pray. Every morning, the building is open from 6 to 9. The staff comes at 7 to pray. So, but you can come, you know, depending on your schedule, work, school, come as early as 6, and as late as 9 o'clock is when the time is for prayer. So take note of that. That's Monday through Friday. Wednesday will be our regular midweek service. I'll be here preaching on Wednesday night, and there's prayer 1 hour before our Wednesday night service at 6 p.m. is prayer. Service is at 7, and then Thursday, Spanish service at 7 p.m. This coming Friday, we have youth gathering together at 7:30 p.m. here in the Edge, and then Saturday prayer outreach in the Edge concert. Prayers at 10. Remember our new time for prayer. Big outreach at 11 o'clock in the morning, and then the Edge with our own bands, testimonies, drama, and preaching the Word of God. Monday, 1 week from tomorrow, we have discipleship class with Pastor Joe Rice from our church in San Diego. So that's 1 week from tomorrow, April 10th. So keep that in mind. And then some of the other regular announcements. We have women's prayer meeting at 6:30 this coming Tuesday. Spanish ministry outreach Monday, 6 p.m. meeting here at the church. There'll be a meeting for those in our drama, Shattered Under the USA Flag, after the morning service. Now that conference is behind us, we start registration for boot camp. See Luis and Caroline at the tape room, and you can start that process starting this morning. Sign up for boot camp. Concerning the offering, I want to make a few comments just before Pastor Jerry comes. Thursday night, we took pledges. We had a lot of pledges come in. We need every penny of those pledges. So if you have a pledge for world evangelism, make sure you designate it to Conference World Evangelism Pledge. On Friday, Pastor Roman took an offering. We had a number of other people make pledges, quite a significant number of pledges. We need every penny of those pledges to finish paying for the conference. So if you have that pledge from Friday night, you can just designate that conference offering pledge. Thursday night, world evangelism is designated World Evangelism Pledge. Friday night, if you made a pledge, it's conference pledge. So just designate that, whether it's this morning, tonight, or in the next week or so, so that we can organize that correctly and we know what we're dealing with. Let's welcome Pastor Jerry as he comes.
Amen. Amen. I was just had the privilege of being able to sit through Pastor Stephen's Sunday school class, and I didn't mean for it to turn out like this, but if you're not in that Sunday school class, I really recommend it. Amen. The scripture that he was using is the one that I'm going to use for the offering this morning, and I'll tie that in with us in Africa. But Deuteronomy 8:18 says, "And you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth." Amen. And see, everybody wants to hear that, and everyone wants to know the secret on the power to get wealth. Amen? No? God's going to help you, ma'am. Nobody else. Hallelujah. But the rest of that scripture says that he may establish his covenant, which he swore to your fathers, as it is this day. And see, the reality about wealth and money is it's all about covenant. Amen. And here we are in the conference, amen. And I started thinking about my pastor, Pastor Stevens, amen. And I started thinking about the mindset of our pastor, amen, and how he has a vision for world evangelism, amen. Four continents, hallelujah. Four continents, amen, we're reaching from this congregation. And Pastor Mitchell said on that final night, man, and it was powerful. He says, man, Pastor Stevens is the real deal. Hallelujah. And I was hearing Joseph talk this morning in the serious men's class. Amen. And Joseph was talking about stories where he's had to believe God for finances, but how he's able to call Pastor Stevens and he feels a little timid and asking for finances. But Pastor always tells him, Joseph, what do you need? Amen. I also understand that I've called him many a times, amen, and asked him for finances more than I'd probably like to admit, amen. And sometimes I'm apologizing. Pastor, I know it's expensive. He's like, Jerry, shut up. What do you need? Amen. And can I tell you, it's because the covenant relationship that he has with world evangelism, and it's not possible without you. Hallelujah. Pastor Stevens has that confidence because he knows that God is going to speak to the people of God. Amen. I want to shift real quick. Amen. I want to talk about Africa very quickly. Amen. There's a lot of things that we do. I remember the story of Annette talking about how she wept for a long time with all of the kids and all of the needs that she couldn't meet. Amen. And you see that so much in Africa. There's a kid named Godwin, no father, no mother. I help him with his school. It's a very small amount of money, amen. And this kid came up to me and told me, Pastor, they're not really serious about teaching me at school. The other kids aren't really serious about learning. He says, can you buy me a couple of books so that I could learn on my own? There's a young kid that was urinating blood for 2 years. And he finally had the courage to come ask me. I fixed the problem with $40, amen. There's all sorts of these things that you can go on and on and on about. And I heard this story secondhand, but Leanne from our church here in El Paso went to Sierra Leone or someplace, I believe, for an outreach. And she says, she's telling someone a story of her holding a baby, amen. And you're seeing just the poverty of the nation. And then she remembers at that very moment, Pastor Alvin saying, listen, we're not here to feed these people. We're not here to meet those needs. We're here to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. And that really resounded for me when we planted the church in Anya. And I want to, you know, we had the church already out in Grand Bassan, but that's, you know, in another nation. But this time the church in Accra had the opportunity to be a part of fixing the church, being there, laboring. And there was some instances where Pastor Charles took out wads of cash, your money, amen, and paid for things. And the people in our church were, what the? And something happened where they understood, amen, that you know what? We're the real deal. Hallelujah. They understood that there is an incredible amount of sacrifice that comes from the mother church in El Paso, Texas, because we want to establish something, not food, not medicine, but we want to establish churches, amen, that can change people's lives, hallelujah. And I want the ushers to come forward, amen, as you remember that this morning, that God has, I rejoice, amen, when I come home and I see people being blessed, amen. I rejoice, amen, when people tell me, man, you know, God has blessed us this year. It's because I know that God is doing that because he wants to establish covenant with you. Some of you have not established that covenant. But I believe, amen, like Pastor Stephen said, that this conference was a shift and that there's going to be finances like never before in our congregation. Hallelujah. And I just want to ask, amen, hallelujah. Is that Brother Derek? Amen. If you'd lift your voice, amen, and ask God's blessing over this offering, amen. And we remember, hallelujah, that God's given you what he's given you for this. Amen. Brother Derek.
I've got my mind.
Amen. Just before Pastor Jerry comes to bring the Word of God, we've started a brand new ministry in prison. You've heard of prison ministries before. We've done them before here. But we've had an amazing open door by making contact with a chaplain that has opened doors for us. And Brother Ernie, I think this is the second time he's gone. And I heard such an incredible report from yesterday. He's going to share with us what God did in 2 minutes. And then Enrique is going to come and share what God did there and in your life in 2 minutes. And we're going to be rejoicing when they're done testifying because of what God's doing.
We, when I say we, these group of men right here, Alan, along with, who are we missing, guys? Josh Figueroa. Guys, we went to Sanchez State Jail, which is off of Montana Street and has 1,000 inmates. And many of them have been in prison for a long time or have many years to go. We went in there early Saturday morning, started going into their cells, and many of them still asleep, groggy, etc. We started just talking to them, had an opportunity to be able to witness, pray for some. Then they allowed us to go to get into the segregated unit or the SHU or the hole, where, quite frankly, inmates there are almost like caged animals. And they've been in there, some of them, for a long, long time. Preaching to them, giving them the message of hope. Some of them prayed with us. And then we went to the outside corridor where over 500 of the inmates came out of a state jail of 1,000. And Kingdom Business tore it up. They were so good, so good, so anointed. Angel, Mando, and they're preaching and they're testifying. We had God's dominion there. 238 people prayed. And I'm not just talking corporate prayer. But I'm talking about where we go down and we start talking, surrounded by 5'10", and praying for them. 137 of them prayed for the first time. And it was just powerful.
As we walked in, it was, I don't know how to put it, man. God took me back to when I was in prison. I got saved in prison, and I got baptized in prison. And they say, you know, all jailhouse Christianity doesn't last. Well, I beg to differ, man. I'm still here, and I'm still saved, and I'm serving God. So I walked in, and God takes me back immediately. I'm walking in what they call the bowling alley. It's the middle part where there's the housing. And I mean, he took me back immediately where I remember telling him, God, if you can, I didn't know God, I mean, but I told him, if you make yourself real to me, just change me, I'll serve you. I'll come back and I'll help these men, you know, not make the same mistakes that I've made. And we're walking and I'm trying to keep it together because God is pouring his spirit into me. He's dealing with me. And it's not a good thing, man. I mean, it is, because he was bringing conviction. He just saw me how much I've gotten away from him. Though I am serving God, though I can point out fruit that I have here, there's women and men that are here because we've invested in, and we are doing things for God. We give to world, I mean, we're givers, we're engaged, but not to the point, not to the level that God has called me to be. He wants more of me. And as we're going in, you have to understand, our church is really, through Ernie, we had an invitation. We're not the main speakers. We're not the main church. It's Del Sol, man, and they have this extreme team and whatnot. And I want to tell you, man, we took dominion. We went in there and you know, we got to be with the inmates and whatnot. And then the event started, Kingdom Business started. Adam, I mean, you have to understand just what he doesn't even have a year saved, or maybe a year. And I mean, he's preaching his heart out. I mean, he's doing this, you know, we can't get next to they took us into the segregation, and we're not the main church. You have to understand that. But the chaplain asked us to go in there. What did he see in us? You know, and I mean, we're preaching our lungs out, but it was just amazing, the dominion and that God gave us and the favor. But in me personally, I was humbled. I was convicted because I got to see Angel Medina preach. I mean, short. I mean, 5 minutes, whatever. I don't even know the time, but the dominion that this man has, and I'm excited to see him, that he's going to be evangelizing again, because he doesn't belong sitting down like a lot of men here. You should be preaching the word. And it's not so much the preaching, but what's behind it, is there substance? Is there, if you know, the words that we speak, they have to, you know, they're inmates. What are you going to tell them? Oh, well, I'm successful, this, I have this. No, it's what you're speaking. It's the spirit of God. And I want to tell you something, man. As I'm looking at this, it's just amazing. I mean, there was men that was supposed to be there, and you missed out, man, because the Bible says there's a harvest ready. And those are the true riches of God. And I'm telling you, man, I was praying for 5 here, 10 there, 15. We needed men. We needed men to help us, you know, bring in this harvest. And I want to thank Ernie for inviting me, man, because it's amazing. I mean, I can stand here and tell you so much. I don't have the time, man. But Angel.
It was just a great privilege. Of course, I don't know why they choose me. I can't relate to those people. As many of you guys know, the Hales and the Medinas, we come from an Ivy League family. And so, anyway, it was very powerful. We went to, Ad Seg, you know, I grew up in that environment from a very young age, and it's just normal. It's you know what? But when we went to Ad Seg, like Ernie said, it's like they're like caged animals. And I begin to think this is wrong. This is totally wrong. Humanity deprived of their freedom. But you know what? The gospel works. We preached, you know, we talked to young men. It was powerful. And we're believing that out of this, very soon, young men are going to be standing here and others testifying about God's grace. I asked the chaplain, what's the success rate? And he says, every time a group like this, like Ernie said, and Mondo, we take dominion, comes, something happens in these inmates. And so it was a privilege. Thank you.
Yeah, Angel was born in a Sunday school classroom. Amen. Thank God for that. We one of the great announcements, of course, out of our conference, and it, you know, kind of maybe got buried just a little bit, was announcing Charles and Edna taking over the Accra, Ghana church. It's a huge step when we nationalize a work. That's always our vision when we send in a missionary. There's no, I mean, you can't do it instantly. It will be some years of investment. And you just have to wait and see what God does, what kind of people and personnel you're working with. But I remember meeting Charles when he'd only been in the church maybe a year or so, and he had a touch of grace and anointing on his life. He got saved when Randy and Annette were in Ghana, when Pastor Sarabi and Jenny went in there. He facilitated that transition, came under Jerry's ministry, and has developed it since then. We announced him to pioneer last conference. He's pioneered a congregation, building people. That's happening. So we've been able to replace him with another couple out of the church, and now he'll be going back. And so that's a great success. We were also able to nationalize the Guatemala church this last year. We heard Pastor Giovanni's testimony. So we're very glad to have Pastor Jerry here. He's going to be going home, and I think our target date for them flying back to El Paso will be May 15th or so. And then from here, they're going to be going to Pittsburgh to pioneer a new work for God. So let's give our brother a very, very warm welcome here today. It's like hugging a
hear what he said, but you're laughing, so praise God. Amen. So I just really am grateful for the privilege of this pulpit, amen, and everything, amen, that we've been able to be a part of, amen, from the first time we pioneered to the opportunity. Some don't call it an opportunity to go to Africa, amen, but it is the opportunity of a lifetime, amen, that my pastor, with all of my shortcomings, amen, all of my failures, amen, that he trusts us, that he invests in our lives, hallelujah. We're going to, celebrate our 20th anniversary this year in May, amen. We're going to celebrate it in Africa, hallelujah. And I was telling my pastor, I says, man, you know, I want to do something for Jenny, amen, just because it's, you know, 20 years of putting up with me, amen. So we just are excited to be here. I was talking to Pastor Glenn about preaching Sunday after conference, amen. And how many know it's kind of difficult to get up here after all of these incredible men, the glory of God, amen, all of these things. Pastor Glenn says, yeah, I had to do that one time. And when I finished preaching, I was like, man, did that help anybody? Did that do anything? And I was like, thanks, Pastor Glenn. I'm encouraged. Hallelujah. But he said, no, God's going to help you. It'll be different. Amen. So I want to preach a sermon this morning. You can turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 1, verse 28. Hallelujah. And I want to preach a sermon that I've entitled Amoray Vision. This is my daughter. Amen. She's 11 years old, and she is so precious. I could share so many stories of just how she hears from God and different things. Amen. But really, my heart this morning, even at the pulpit right now, I was praying, God, help me. And I said, no, God, help them. Amen. And my heart this morning is for the people that I love. Amen. There's 25 years of relationship that's sitting under this roof just for me, amen. And I know that it goes deeper and further for some people, hallelujah. But one of the things that conference does is it forces you to examine the relationships that you've built in a congregation. And this is because there is such a huge window that you're able to look at. It'd be one thing if we've been partnering together for a year or two, amen. There's not much that you could see over the course of years, but we're talking about close to 25 years of relationship just in my life with the El Paso congregation. And it's because of this time, it affords you the ability to both see the good and the ugly decisions that people have made over the course of their lives, myself included. And I'm preaching this morning because, Joseph said some powerful things. He says, sometimes people say, oh, you're our hero. But you don't realize, amen, that we still deal with the ugly. Hallelujah. And one of the great things that I begin to see last conference and really came to fruition this conference was this incredible godly heritage of our children. Amen. That they're becoming of age, amen, and that they're blossoming into men and women of God, amen. And it speaks plenty of the good decisions that people and parents and our pastors have made in leading these children over the course of their lives, amen. And also one of the very sad things is that you're also forced to look at the tragedies that have happened. And I don't say that to sound generic, amen, but again, these are people that I have relationship with. These are people that you love and that you care for. And sometimes we understand that there's no real culprit or nothing that you can put your finger on, but often it's because of the direct correlation of the decisions that we've made in our lives. And the reason for this sermon is to get us thinking about what we're doing and what's at risk, amen, if we're unable to see the consequences of our decisions. I want to preach a sermon on discernment, amen. Now, I remember this happened in Africa. Me and my daughter were laying in bed, and my daughter was sobbing. She's crying, and I'm not talking about a soft cry, a heavy cry. And she wasn't crying because she was sad. And I said, Mama, what's wrong? Why are you crying? And she says, Dad, I'm just so happy that I have such a good dad and that I have such a good mom and family. And she says, in one day, you're going to give me away at an altar so that we can do something for God. And I was overwhelmed with that. And this is, I can't see my sermon no more. Hold on. I still can't. A contact moved. I'm sorry. I think it fell out. Really? Come on. Hallelujah. Now, I was thinking about that. There we go. And I was thinking of my daughter and the joy, amen, that I was experiencing in that time. And we have to ask ourselves, amen, what is it that people are thinking, amen, when they're willing to sell out their Christianity? When they're willing to leave, amen, the church where God has whispered in their ear and validated their lives and dismiss the will of God? Do they not see what they're risking? What they're going to lose, amen. Do they not see all of these godly moments, amen, that I spent with my daughter, amen? Do they not see, amen, the joy, the destiny, amen, the posterity, amen, all of the generational blessing that God wants to give us? Do they not see what they're doing and all for the sin that the Bible says is only pleasurable for a season? The question that I want to start this sermon out with is, don't you see what you're doing? Hallelujah. And I know that that's a rough question to ask after all that you've sacrificed and given, and amen. But I really felt stirred, amen, because God was speaking that to me this week in conference. And there's issues, amen, that are close to home for me, that even after 25 years of salvation, after pastoring, after seeing all that God has done, there's still things that God is telling me, don't you see, Jerry? And I really believe that God wants to speak to us this evening, amen. Romans chapter 1, verse 28 through 32, and it says, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness, their whispers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but also approve of those who practice them. Father, I pray that you would speak to us this morning, that you would cause there to be dominion and revelation, God, that you would touch and salvage and help in the mighty name of Jesus. I said it right now that, you know, we have just experienced, amen, the glory of God this week, amen. But one of the things that I know and that I remember, amen, is sometimes that there are people, and many of those people are the people of the faithful saints of God, that they're standing on the outside of that. And they're watching all of these things happen and the different announcements and the different things. And there's sometimes there's people, they can become indifferent. They can say, oh, well, why this brother? Or, oh, well, why that brother? Or they can even not even really recognize what's happening in the conference because they're going through their own personal issues. They're going through their own, problems in life, having to figure out life. And I desperately believe, God, this morning that God needs to give you discernment, amen, over the issues that you're facing in life. Discernment comes from the same word that means heart, amen. In other words, it's a matter of the heart, amen. It's figuratively speaking, it's saying it's a very widely used for the feelings or the will or even the intellect. It means in the midst of the things of the heart, of the soul, the heart of man, the mind, the knowledge, the thinking, the reflection, the memory, inclination, resolutions, determination of will. All of these words are what compose this word, hallelujah. Hallelujah, discernment. And what I'm here to tell you is that God's able to call upon all the faculties of the human personality to come to this place of discernment. Amen. It involves this incredible array of things in our personalities. Again, our heart, our ability to reflect on the past, to be able to think of the future, all of these things, amen. And we need this morning to make that vital connection when it comes to making the decisions that we're faced with this morning. You have to be able to make the connection with the ones that you love this morning. I want you to make this personal in your heart. You have to make that connection with the ones that love you, hallelujah. And you have to bring them into the forefront of your mind. There is no time this morning for the island mentality. There's no time for after a conference like this to go home or to be here in the mother church and be concerned with me, 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 hallelujah. You have to feel the incredible weight of the possibility of things that could go wrong. I remember 3 years ago, amen, before we got sent out to Ghana, me and my wife for the first time felt like, you know what, this year we're not going overseas. We've always wanted to go overseas. And I always ask my pastor, amen, pastor, if there's a need overseas, we're ready. And this is the first time that you said, no, you know what, we got to do some stuff still in Denver. There's things to be accomplished, et cetera, amen. And I remember going into pastor's office, amen. And he says, so how's Denver doing? And I'm telling him, and I'm like, man, he's not even there's something going on. It's like he didn't even hear, amen, because he had something in his eyes, hallelujah. And I remember that before going into that office, amen, my wife and I, God was able to give us a glimpse of the future if we said no, amen. And he began to show us, hallelujah, and playing out the danger of our minds of not responding to God, the danger of the implications it could have upon our kids, upon our family, not just my family, but my extended family, upon my ministry, upon my marriage, amen. We answer the call because God's given us a taste of this and we understand this. Never in my life was I moved to go to Africa. Amen. I remember a brother came up to me after the service. Hey, you finally got what you wanted. Amen. Not really. Hallelujah. But God did. Amen. And I remember we get there and we're going through all that we're going through. And I remember my wife and kids almost went into, for lack of a better word, they like a depression. They'll testify about it and how they were able to fight that off. And the second they get the victory, my wife's back goes up. And there are people that are saying, why don't you just come back home? There are the thoughts in my mind and my wife's mind and our kids' minds, amen. And they're saying, you know what, you know, there's this noise that's saying, you need to just get out of here, amen. But again, God's giving me a picture of the future. He's saying that if we leave, amen, if you walk away from this, amen, that you're going to hinder what God wants to do, amen, in the progress of the church, in our lives, amen, in our family. And see, you have to be willing to ask yourself this morning, don't you see what you're doing? Amen. Now, I don't want to scare everybody, hallelujah, because that's not really what the sermon's about. Amen. But we also have to have the ability to see the future for the good things that God has for our lives. And this is what I call Amore vision, amen. It's much of what Pastor talked about in the conference and Pastor Glenn saying those words, you know, my fear is that we don't really fully understand the generational revival that God wants to give us, amen. But you and I need to learn to cultivate that ability, amen, to see all the good that's possible by making right decisions. The people that are running from calling, you have to see the couples that God wants to raise up in your city. The people that are running from the connection of the church, you have to begin to see, amen, the posterity, amen, the godly heritage that he wants to impart into your children and your children's children, amen, by staying in place and doing what you need to do. I talk to Mike all the time, Pastor Michael Major, amen, hallelujah. And I tell him, any man who's a discipler of men has to ask himself the question, have I been able to reach so deep into that man or that woman to plant the seed of the gospel that it's going to affect his children's children? Hallelujah. This is what we're involved in, amen. And you and I have to use those same faculties of our emotion, of our heart, amen, to make good and righteous decisions, hallelujah, so that we can see all the good things that God has for us, amen. So that we can discern for the decisions that need to be made this conference, amen. This is something that I tell you, I'm not trying to get all emotional and just want to make you cry, but this is something that Jesus did. Hallelujah. Hebrews 12:2, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. That Jesus, at the most difficult moment in his life, was able to discern and see into the future. And what he tapped into wasn't all the possibilities of the things that could go wrong, but he was tapping into the possibilities of this conference. The possibilities of you and I when we accepted him, amen. The possibility, he tapped into the joy, the good, the amore vision, amen, for your life and my life, amen. The height, the depth, all the joy that you can experience over a lifetime of making decisions, good decisions. Listen, it's unthinkable, amen. I would have never imagined. I can't help but think, Pastor Stevens, amen. You know, all that God has been able to do in his life, all that he's able to see, amen. The joy that he must have felt seeing his children making right decisions, difficulties, whatever, amen. But now his children's children, amen. And seeing this, listen, God has that for you and I, amen. That this is not simply, amen, someone else's vision, amen. That's not, you know, that church's vision. Listen, this needs to be your vision. Hallelujah. See, I want to look with you, amen, at the reality of those that are undiscerning, amen. Proverbs 15:21 says, folly is joy to him who is destitute of discernment. In other words, amen, that the joy of foolish people, amen, that foolishness is the joy of those that are undiscerning, those that have no ability to see things for what they are, unable to decide, amen. Proverbs says that these kind of men and women take pleasure in foolishness, in unrighteousness, amen. And this is a man or a woman that's destitute of discernment. And in our scripture, in our text, amen, it talks about a giving over, hallelujah, that's released on people, amen, of unrighteousness, an unrighteous people, a people that because of their unwillingness to repent, amen, they've been given over and filled with all of these things. It says in our text, being filled with all unrighteousness, listen to the weight of these words, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit. And this is what God was doing in me when I thought of this sermon. He spoke to me. Whispers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents. And then it drops in this word undiscerning. It's almost, in my mind, it was like, man, that doesn't even fit right there. All of these things that he's talking about are so wicked and egregious. Murderers, God hate, undiscerning. My inability to see things the way they really are, amen. And the reason, amen, I believe that God has put it in that same category, amen, is because this is really the culprit of so many tragedies in life. The things that I talked about when I opened my sermon, amen. And the reason the word of God, amen, is so just harsh on that and puts that in there, amen. How many know is because wicked people can't see the harm that comes from their choices. They never see it ending the way it ends, amen. They never consider, hallelujah, the children of the flesh. And I started thinking, I says, you know what, man? It's not just, it's me. That the people of God have to deal with this. We heard so many things about Abraham, amen. Here is a man that we're able to enter into the vision, amen, of the covenant that God made with him, hallelujah. But how many know there were some moments in Abraham's life where he lacked some discernment, amen. And we even see in Scripture, Genesis 2:10, that he pays a price for that. It says, therefore, she said to Abraham, cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be an heir with my son, namely with Isaac. And the matter was very displeasing to Abraham because it was his son. See, when you and I lack discernment, amen, and we make decisions that are sown in the flesh, hallelujah, there's always going to be consequences. That is going to assault the decisions, amen, and the sons of our spirit. And we see that Abraham, amen, is vexed because of this. He's having to face the very real consequences, amen, that now I'm going to have a son that does not have a father. He's having to face the realities of his lack of discernment, amen. And I realize, amen, that you and I are no different, amen. I realize that there are things, amen, even though God has done incredible things, there are things that I've not made the right decisions on. That there are things, amen, that even in this conference, even at this altar, amen, even with talking, I realize, amen, talking with my pastor, my wife, that you know what, man, listen, you better make up your mind on these things. God gave them in our text over to a debased mind, amen, because they were unable to discern where they were at in life. And I want to tell you, amen, debased mind is a picture of something, of a life that has not been approved. It's been deemed something that is unapproved. The word means by implication, it's worthless. It's a castaway. It's rejected. Amen. And the why of this unapproval is found in our ability or inability to process, amen, the wisdom and the instruction that God is trying to give us. Amen. And the reason this sin is so egregious to God and in the Word of God is that if you and I lack the ability to grasp something, amen, if we're not figuring something out, and I'm talking about my life, your life, amen, if we can't figure something out, how many know God doesn't give us excuse, amen? If you lack the wisdom to comprehend the weight of our actions, amen, all you have to do is ask. We're without excuse. It's been given to man to have wisdom. It's been given to man the ability to discern life, to make right decisions. James 1:5 says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to you. Amen. Not only is wisdom available, church, but listen, it's available in an ever-increasing measure. Proverbs 9:9 says, give instruction to a wise man and he will still be wiser. Teach a righteous man and he will increase his learning. Amen. The wise becomes wiser. Teach the wise and he'll increase. And this is a basic principle of the kingdom of God that's found in Isaiah 9:7. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. It is in ever-increasing measure that God wants us to attain instruction and wisdom to discern, amen, the issues of life. There's a direct correlation to increase, blessing, and our ability to take heed to instruction and correction. Joseph Muriel, God was on him this week, man. I've never seen Joseph talk like that. And he, and it's not just me, amen. He, so many people, I was like, man, he's in love with what God is doing. He's in love, amen, with his nation, with the people, with where his family's at, amen. And I started looking at that and thinking of that. Pastor Joseph told a story when he got launched into China that he went into pastor's office for marriage counseling and that he left, amen, on his way to China. And I thought, you know, that's a funny story to tell. But the reality is he went into his pastor's office because he wanted instruction. And he wanted correction. And I know, amen, Pastor Joseph was saying over there, you know, you guys look at these things, amen, but my family, ha, 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 they really know who I am. That means that we're still trying to face these truths about our lives. And it's when you will finally grab hold of it, it's then that God will release something in your life. God begin to deal with me, amen. How do you handle instruction? How do you handle correction? And I think of my own church, and I think of when I correct somebody or I have to rebuke somebody, amen. You know, a lot of times, amen, people can get an attitude. Or they get angry, amen. They ignore the person that corrects them. Maybe it's not pastor, but it's a friend. And you, I don't want to get around that brother, amen. That sister, they're just, you know, super spiritual. Or they get mad at that person. Or they get mad at their pastor. And see, the danger is that you can eventually come to a place where you're just mad at God. Amen. And I begin to, you know, realize that, you know what, Jerry, you're at a pivotal place. Amen. You heard my word. Amen. Critical moments. in my life. And I began to understand that there are so many people that are in that same place. That you and I, amen, can find ourselves, even in the midst of all that God is doing, find ourselves in these critical moments, amen. But how do we handle that? And it was during a conference, amen, that I was worried about a relationship that I was having with an individual, amen. I'm bothered at the way, amen, our relationship is, amen. And I began to ask God, you know, man, I wonder what he's saying about me. God said, what are you saying about him, amen? Rebuked me. He corrected me, and I began to pray and think, amen. And what God gave me was Amore vision. He says, you know what, man? If you would simply get those relationship rights, I could do incredible things with you guys, amen. And he's talking about that direct covenant that I should have with that person. Proverbs 19:20, it says, listen to counsel and accept discipline that you may be wise the rest of your days. So this scripture, it's saying that there is a direct correlation, amen, with your future, with the rest of your days, amen, on how you're going to take instruction. Listen, you want wisdom on what you need to do. You need revelation, amen. You need discernment, amen. You can ask God, and he's faithful to give it to you. And I begin to think over the course of my life, the issues, amen, that I'm needing to deal with. God has been faithful to speak to me, but I've not been faithful to take it, amen. That there are things, and I'm not saying, amen, that I'm up here all crazy, lost my mind, amen. But I'm saying that there are issues while God is doing incredible things in your life or not. There's still issues, amen, that you need to take and see them for what they're worth, hallelujah. Really, this is all dependent on how and what you deem is valuable. Amen. The reality of how you respond to the issue of discernment or the lack of discernment is found in what you deem valuable. Proverbs tells us in 16:16, how much better is it to get wisdom than gold, and to get understanding is to be chosen above silver. And see, Proverbs isn't addressing, amen, this idea of greed, amen, but I believe it's addressing the idea or the issue of appearance, amen. Someone who's motivated by gold or silver over wisdom and understanding is a person who generally is more interested in how people see them rather than the reality of the situation of their life. And a victorious life isn't about appearance, amen. But real value is found in our ability to discern. Real value is found in our ability to choose what's right, amen. I begin to look up this word discernment, amen, as I close, amen. And discernment is a verb that literally means to sit down with. And it's a picture, amen, of people that pull up a chair, amen. Let's pull up a chair this morning, hallelujah, and begin to discuss the reality of where they're at, amen. They begin to discuss and look at the right information, and they're doing this, listen to me, with the right people, with the right priorities, amen. See, our problem many a times in life, and I know this even in my own life, amen, is that you and I begin to discern, or we begin to reason with the wrong things or the wrong people. Who are you reasoning with this morning? And it's a very crucial skill set that you and I reason with the right people, with the right information, the right priorities. And the problem, again, is that many a times, amen, we reason and we consult the wrong things. A couple of pictures in Scripture, Pontius Pilate, he reasoned with the crowd, amen. How many know when you answer the call of God, not just to preach the gospel, to be a radical, amen, believer, amen, that the crowd will come against you? You're never going to have, amen, the ability to discern properly if you listen to the crowd. King Rehoboam, amen, reasoned with his ungodly peers. The kingdom was split and there was untold consequences. There are some of you that are being weighed in the balances this morning. Are you asking the carnal brothers and sisters in church? The Bible says that we can reason with our own hearts. Luke 9, 46 through 48 says, an argument arose between them to which one of them was the greatest. But Jesus, knowing the reasoning of their hearts, took a child, put him by his side and said to them, whoever receives this child in my name receives me. Whoever receives me receives him who sent me. For he who is least among you all is the one who's greatest. Amen. And see, this scripture, what it's doing is it's telling us, listen, there is a problem with consulting your heart in the issues of life. And he set them straight. He says, you know what? The way you see things isn't correctly. He says, the least are the greatest. This is what he's trying to tell them. Are you able to hear that? Amen. This morning, God's spoken to me about those things. You know, Jerry, you this and this. He says, but you're not seeing this right, son. And thank God that he's faithful to help me. And thank God that he's here this morning to help you. Amen. And that there is hope for us. Amen. That after 20 years, amen, of marriage, after 25 years of living for God, that I haven't dug a hole, amen, where I'm buried in it now. But that God, amen, still gives us hope. This is our hope, amen. Isaiah 1:3, it says that the ox knows its owner and the donkey its master's crib. But Israel does not know. My people do not consider. This is the accusation of God to his people. We're not talking about the world this morning. We're talking about the people of God. Do you and I fail to consider? God has accused his people of this failure to consider. No discernment, amen. And he's saying, listen, if you're going to get it, you must take me up at my offer. The way that we can discern properly in life and make the right decisions that we could see the glory of God fall on our lives is answering the invitation that he gives us in Isaiah 1:8. And he says, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. And though they are red like crimson, they shall be like wool. In other words, God says, let's sit down together this morning. My hope, amen, is that that's what takes place at this altar. And for some of us, amen, it may be more than the altar, amen. It may be that you need to sit down and talk with our pastor. That we would sit down and reason with God, amen. And as we do that, as we reason with him, as we reason with the right person, hallelujah, not with the crowd, not with our own carnality or our carnal friends, amen, but that we would reason with God. Listen to me. God opens our eyes, amen. He says that if you would reason with me, that there's something that happens that we see that we're blood red, amen. And we see, amen, that he's white. We begin to understand, amen, hallelujah, that the only thing we can do, hallelujah, is rely on him. Romans 12:1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable sacrifice. There's that word again. That if you and I would pull up a chair with God this morning at this altar, and that we would stop, amen, going in every direction and just say, God, me and you, what's really happening here, God? Help me to discern this. Help me to see this, amen, because our lives depend on it, hallelujah. And I believe, amen, that the problem many a times, because listen, God will speak to you, he's faithful, but it doesn't mean that it's over, amen. God will show you the issues here, amen. And I look back over the course of my life, amen, I'm not a cat, hallelujah, the course of my life. And I've seen all the good decisions, amen, that I can accredit, you know, my children and fruit and couples and what God is doing. But I also see moments where I fell before God and he gave me the answer. but I respond carnally. And I think that's why you can't do, that's why you can't bring this to pass. You can't finish this in my life. And I believe, amen, many of us understand what I'm saying. 1 Peter 1:13. This is the answer, amen. Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Pastor, that message set me free, church. Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, amen. Be sober and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. You know what our hope is, amen? Is that when God speaks to us, amen, that He has given us the ability to gird up the loins of our mind, our flesh. That when God gives you the answer that you so need to hear this morning, it's hard, amen? It's not easy. But when He gives it to you, that along with that, that you and I, church, would gird up the loins of our flesh. That we say, I'm not going to respond in the flesh. This time I'm going to simply, amen, allow God to give me the ability to make the right decision. Hallelujah. And I tell you, church, that eye has not seen. Amen. That all of these stars, amen, aren't just for our pastors and our missionaries, but it's for the people of God, amen. But are you willing to see what you're doing this morning, amen? I'd like every head bowed and every eye closed. Reverence to God and reverence to what He's doing. Hallelujah. And I pray that this morning, amen, that God has spoken to you, that God has supernaturally, amen, guided this arrow to your heart, that it's touched those that need to be touched, amen. And I preach this again, not because I think small of, man, I love this church. I love the people of God. I love what God is doing. But I preach this, amen, because I understand the reality of it. Even in my life, even at the altars this week, God is doing this in my heart, amen. And I've made a covenant with God that I'm not going to respond in the flesh. That I'm going to gird up the loins of my mind. And I'm not going to allow it to go anywhere, amen, that it shouldn't go, amen. Now I want to challenge you in this place, amen. Maybe you're here and this is what you're going through. God's going to speak to you at this altar, but you're going to have to make a decision that you're not going to respond to the voice of God in your flesh, in your carnality. And I'm going to open the altar in a moment, but before I do that, amen, we have the glorious opportunity of repentance. Maybe you're in this place this morning and you're not saved. You're not right with God, amen. Maybe you're in this place and as you're listening to the sermon, you realize that, man, the decisions that I've made, the things that I've done, amen, they're going to cause consequence in my life. Or maybe you're living with the consequences of your decisions this morning, amen, and you want to be set free. You say, you know what, Pastor Jerry, I want to get my heart right with God. I'm tired of living for myself. I'm tired of not living for God. I want to be saved. I want to get my heart right with God once again. Maybe you're backslidden or you've never known the love of Jesus. Amen. Listen, there is no shame in answering an altar call this morning. That we are going to shame the devil. Amen. For the grip and the chains that he's had that are now broken, amen. When you respond, amen, to say, God, you know what, I want to get my heart right with you. And you say, you know what, Pastor Jerry, that's me this morning. I need to make a decision. I no longer want to live my life the way I'm living. I want to be right with God. Quickly lift up your hand. Quickly, front to back and left to right, amen. God sees this hand. Anyone else? God sees this hand. Anyone else? You say, that's me. Maybe you've never been saved. You're not right with God. Listen, God, amen, wants to bring you into a glorious place. He wants to adopt you as a son or a daughter into the family of God. Welcome home this morning. But it's going to take a decision. I'm not right with God, but I want to be. Never accepted Jesus. You're back. God sees these hands. Anyone else? God sees this hand. Anyone else? You say, that's me. I want to get my heart. Maybe you're backslidden. Maybe you're looking at things all wrong. You have had no ability, amen, to reason all that's taking place in your heart, all that's going on this conference, and you sit there this morning angry or indifferent with God and with man. Listen, God can fix you at this altar. You say, that's me, Pastor. I'm that person. That's what I'm going through. I want to get my heart right. Quickly, lift up your hand. Quickly, hallelujah. Don't fight God, amen. Don't you see what you're doing? Quickly lift up your hand. You say, that's me. Hallelujah. Anybody else? Front to back, left to right. You're not right with God. You want to be. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Quickly, amen. Amen. God is good. Amen. Those of you that lifted up your hand, I want you to get up quickly from your seat. Ushers, if you could begin to help me with that. Hallelujah. That you would begin to bring those, amen, to the front. That they could, we can have some altar workers to work with these. There was a lady over here. Amen. Sister right here in the back. Did you mean that? Amen. God's going to help you. If I could have a sister pray with her. There's a brother right here in the front. Amen. God's going to help you. Amen. Hallelujah. I have a sister right here. Amen. God's going to help you. Hallelujah. Years of relationship. You are the people that I love more than anything. And we all know what it feels like to see someone that you love going down that wrong road. God, help us this morning. God, help us this morning, amen. God's dealing with you still, amen. Get out of your seat. Just come. Get out of your seat. Come. You know it's you. You know, amen, God has spoken to you, amen. Hallelujah. We're going to open this altar to the church, amen. You get out of your seat, hallelujah. You find a place to pray. Cry out, God, I need discernment this morning. I need you, amen, to sit down with me at this altar and reason with me. Let us reason together, God says. Take him at his invitation this morning. Conference is over. God is on the move, amen, and I want to tell you that you are a crucial and integral part of that this morning. That the world, the missionaries, our churches depend on you, amen, making these decisions. That the untold, amen, couples and nations of the world, amen, come to this place, whether or not the people of God would reason with him. Will you recognize his voice this morning? Will you recognize that he's calling you out, amen, that you should be separated unto him, that you should begin to ask him, God, I don't no longer want to respond to the words that you speak to me, amen, with indignance, or I don't want to respond anymore, amen, to the words you speak to me with the carnality of my mind. Take up, amen, gird, amen, the loins of your mind. Bring it into check, hallelujah. Oh, shaka tarababa shoro bobo yala raka tarabaso. Hallelujah, Jesus shobo boro kuturo bobo bo sandarababa baso. Hallelujah. On bended knee I come with a humble heart. Hallelujah, rakatarabababasukuturuboshando. God, I pray, God, that you would meet with us at this altar, God, this morning, God. God, that you would help us and challenge us, God. God, that you would speak to us, God. God, that you would begin to whisper in the ear of your saints, oh God, this morning, God, begin to challenge your people, oh God. Begin to deal with the issues, God, that we've not dealt with at this altar, God. That even in the midst of all of the glory, of all of the God, God. Help us not to, amen, discern properly. God, that we would no longer give, amen, birth, God, to sons of the flesh, to sons of disobedience, God. But that we would allow you, amen, to help us this morning. That you would allow us to reason with you, to take seat with you right here this morning, God. And to hear from you, God. You move supernaturally, God. You do only what you can do in this place, God. Help us. Help me, oh God, to take instruction, to take correction, oh God. Help us to hear from you at this altar, oh God. God, you do something miraculous, God. You take what the canker worm has destroyed and you renew it, God. You take the decisions of the flesh that we've made, God, and you repair those and help us to begin to plant the seeds, amen, today, Father. Oh,
with a humble heart I come, bowing down before your holy throne, lifting holy hands to you as I pledge my heart anew. I worship you in spirit. I worship you in truth. Make my life a holy praise unto you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. I don't see, is Victor Reyes here this morning? Senior? Big Victor? Amen. Where? Victor, where's your wife? I want you to come. Amen. Hallelujah. Or you can stay there. It's okay. Hallelujah. Listen, God spoke to me, amen, to tell you, stand up, amen. Don't worry. I love you guys. Hallelujah. But God was speaking to me, amen, right now. It wasn't something that, but right now, amen, There's a saying, the best time to have planted a tree, I think, was 100 years ago, amen. And the second best time is right now, amen. That we can't, amen, fix any of the decisions that we've made in the past. You can't change that, hallelujah. But again, I say that, and you know, that's almost cliche to say, but it's because it has to do with the issue of roots, hallelujah. And there's something that God wants to do, amen, but you need to make a decision that you're going to plant your tree, amen? That you're going to plant your tree and that all of the decisions of the past, that we don't have the shade and we don't have the blessing of those things from the past. Listen, if you plant it today, hallelujah, it's still coming, amen? Believe God's going to help you, hallelujah, amen. Oh, thank you, Jesus. God, I thank you for this couple, God. You minister, you help them and touch them in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen, amen. Amen. Let's stand to our feet and let's worship God. Hallelujah. As Pastor comes, amen. Let's give him a clap offering, church. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen.
Good. Yeah, are we on? All right, we're going to dismiss. What a great word this morning. Let's really do everything we can to be in prayer tonight. All that God did is going to be sustained in the prayer place, and so let's really make that our priority. 5:30, 6:30, we're going to begin worship. Pastor Roderick Gonzalez, we're going to have a great time tonight. Let's dismiss. Our heads are bowed. Our eyes are closed. We're going, rejoicing in all that God is doing. I'm asking if Richard Lopez would lift his voice and dismiss us this morning.